Welcome back to MedTech Unplugged. My name is Dave Vellante, and you're watching theCUBE plus NYSE Wired's ongoing series focused on medical technology. We're looking at aging population, the intersection of that with AI innovations, value-based and personalized care, and the consumerization of healthcare. Kurt Haggstrom is here. He's the chief commercial officer at a company called Synchron. Very interesting case here, Kurt. Welcome.
Yeah, so Synchron is a company we've been around for about 12 to 13 years. We are developing what will be the world's first commercial brain-computer interface that's implantable. We're taking a little bit different route, and that is through the blood vessels to get to the brain and understand how that works. But the big need out there is that there's millions of people that have lost the ability to use their hands and to connect to the digital world. And so by having this implant, it establishes that connection and restoring independence and autonomy for these individuals.
So these individuals, their brain is functioning just fine, but their motor skills are not, and they're super frustrated, they can't communicate with their families, and so you're addressing that problem.
Absolutely, yeah, and if you think about it, everybody almost has somebody that knows somebody that has been burdened by a stroke, spinal cord, degenerative diseases like ALS that are just devastating. All these lead to that lack of independence or that loss of motor function. And it's, at this point, really tough to restore that actual physical motor function, but can we restore function in a different way? And nowadays, everybody's carrying around a personal device, a supercomputer in their pocket, but not everybody can use it. So we want to allow them to have that function back, reestablishing that connection to the smart world.
And to have a quality of life where they can interact with their surroundings.
Absolutely, isolation and personal isolation is really big for these individuals, and unfortunately, because of that burden of disease, that's occurring now. And so, you know, like all of us, that social, being able to get that social community feeling back for individuals, or even talk to their loved ones, is essential.
So this is a brain-computer interface that with an implantable device,
you have a picture
of it. Let's take a look.
Yeah, we're very excited about it. So this is our latest version. Just about to get back in trials here. So this is what you call the Stentrode. So this, the full system's called the Synchron BCI, brain computer interface. This portion of it right here looks like a stent or the mesh. That's the Stentrode. This is very, very unique, and this allows you to go through a blood vessel, through a little tiny tube, go up into the brain, you place this device in a minimally invasive fashion. This device embeds just like a normal stent does in the blood vessel, but what it does is allow you to listen to the brain actually without touching the brain. So the person can think of moving, think of different actions, and that gives you the control of your smart device.
So that mesh is inserted via a catheter into the blood vessel?
That's correct, yes.
In through the neck?
Absolutely, right? Yes. You go right up through one of the main veins in your neck here. And this is a procedure that's done in thousands of cath labs today. And so that's the novelty and the scalability of the approach that we're taking is that all these interventionalists that are treating stroke today in every hospital that's in every big city, in every small city, they can do this procedure tomorrow. And so once approved, they can do this procedure tomorrow.
But it's a proven technique that's been used many thousands of times.
Yeah, the skills needed for this are standard. The catheter tools are off the shelf in every hospital. So there's nothing new special about approaching, using and implanting this technology.
And it avoids open brain surgery, no drilling of the skull.
That's big. If you think about in the history of BCI in general, it has always required you to remove the skull, drilling through the skull, and actually putting probes inside the brain itself. That's been done for the last 20 years. Our approach said, well, ultimately the brain doesn't like things in it, and the skull doesn't like to be removed. And so, is there a different way to get to those brain signals? And that's what Synchron's been able to do.
And this if you could zoom in again, Todd and John. So this right here, what is this piece of it, and where does that go?
Great question. So the Stentrode portion goes up inside the blood vessel. It then carries down through a lead through your blood vessel, and then under the skin is where this transceiver stays. So this is what collects the signal, and then sends the signal out Bluetooth now to the, say, Apple operating system to be able to control an iPad or an iPhone. So this is what, again, Bluetooth's out your raw signal. and you can't see it. It's all invisible. It's under the skin. You can't see anything. And then it recharges just like your iPhone. So there's a paddle that rests over while you're just sitting or sleeping. And all of a sudden, you wake up, you're charged, and you're ready to send out signal.
It's almost like wireless charging when you put your phone
100%,
on.
It's that simple.
People are, of course, familiar with Neuralink. How was this similar? How was it different?
Yeah. So I think similar in that we're trying to collect the neural signals and then take those and control smart devices and smart technologies for people that have lost function. Our approach is very, very different though. Because we're going through the blood vessels, it allows a minimally invasive approach, and we never have the rejection from the brain tissue itself or having to open the skull. All those require a very specialized neurosurgeon or robotics. Ours can be done by these interventionalists at every hospital that's out there in the country. So the scalability of our approach is, I think, one of the key aspects of our technology and the durability over time, because we know stents last decades in people, right? So we're capitalizing on that same healing process that occurs in the cardiology world that we're using for our technology.
I mean, I would suspect, Kurt, that neural patterns are much different in the reaction to different injuries or disease, or much different across patients. How do you adapt to those differences and sort of personalize the experience?
Yeah, good question. I mean, I think to start is that to be able to implant these technologies and know that the person has the cognitive function, there's a consent in the making sure that the person has the cognitive abilities. So you do cognitive tests and consent that they want the technology, certainly, especially if they don't have speech anymore. When it comes to individuals and their neural patterns, this is kind of the beauty of AI to a point, is that, believe it or not, although some neural patterns are different, our interpretations of things are different, when you look at the motor function and how I'm moving my left hand, you moving your left hand is in the same portion of the brain, not made look exactly the same, but similar enough that you can make these generic models to be able to have that generic control over that smart device. So if you want to move a cursor, our way of moving the cursor would probably be pretty similar from a neural pattern.
Interesting. So what happens to all the data? I mean, you're streaming a lot of information. Where does that go? How do you protect privacy? What is the state of that in your business?
Yeah, so obviously data privacy is, as you know, foremost, very, very important from a cybersecurity standpoint. FDA has very strict guidelines on medical devices, patient information, just like our smartphones, right? I mean, if you think about the data that's collecting and the protection around it. So the beauty is that, you know, we're not entering the market, 10 years ago. We're entering the market in the coming years. And so when you think about the state-of-the-art data privacy, cybersecurity, you know, making sure that we protect the data with the most stringent, standards and regulations that are out there today and the FDA requires, I think we're lucky because we're entering that time when that capability is there. So making sure that we put all the barriers of data privacy and protection into the system as possible.
And so the regulatory frameworks that you are subject to are in place already? It's not like crypto where there's a lot of confusion, or is this clarity?
So to be clear, this is a class 3 medical device. So much like a pacemaker or a deep brain stimulator, all these are the template for regulatory environments is there today. So that's again the beauty of launching an innovative technology like this. It's not necessarily innovative on the regulatory side of it. They have these understandings of what does safety look like? What do we need to see for efficacy? How long is a study? How many patients? So all these regulatory fundamentals are already built into our system through the FDA.
What about reimbursement? I mean, how do you get paid? Can you quantify the value to payers? Do you have enough data yet?
Yeah, big question. And I think ultimately that will have to be proven out over time, is the value of now establishing independence and autonomy for those that have lost it. What is the value to that? I think quality of life, there's no question we're going to see quality of life improvements, but how does their health improve over this? So this is a journey that we're going to go through with the payers, such as CMS. And so we're starting these conversations today and have been over the last couple years and saying, what evidence do you need to see in order to say, have this device coverage, covered when it gets to the commercial environment? Because for us, we don't want just to be a select few to be able to afford this. We want it to be able to scale to everyone that needs it, not just that can afford it.
What about the ecosystem that you're developing? When I hear iOS, I think App Store, I think developers. Do you have an ecosystem of developers? Are you reaching, is there a developer affinity? What are you doing with third-party applications?
Yeah, so at first we're opening up, you know, on the Apple operating system, so we're working with them to make sure we have a seamless connection into that operating system, and we have some exciting news that we're going to be talking about here in the coming months.
Oh, great, okay.
So that should be really exciting for us. But once it gets there, I think when you look at app development and people now understanding that there's a different way to control and act within the Apple environment, I think that's going to open the door for developers. So we're going to certainly help develop products for our patients or our users, but ultimately I think that's going to create a new way to interact with a computer that's going to be exciting for the developing developer community.
Where are you in the maturity of your go-to-market?
Yeah.
Are you sort of just starting? I mean, it's interesting to me, you have a technical background, you hold
yes.
patents, and you are the go-to-market lead
yeah.
at this
yeah,
company,
exactly.
which is somewhat rare. It's not completely rare in tech, but it's and certainly not in your field, but
yeah.
but it's an interesting dynamic. I wonder if you could explain where you are in that maturity cycle.
Yeah, and I think sometimes to sculpt the commercial strategy on something so innovative and such high tech is that having a technical background has really helped me over the years. So for us though, the big things that we think we're actually ahead in this space is that we've done two clinical trials to date. So we did a first in human trial in Australia with the first four patients. We've then did six patients in an IDE early feasibility trial here in the United States. We got 12 month feedback on that for safety. So we've established a really good foundation of safety profile for our approach. And that's really important when you think about these long-term implantables. So our next phase is really getting into that pivotal trial that's going to get us to market. So the pivotal trial gives you that FDA clearance to be able to go to market. And so that's really our next big endeavor from a clinical standpoint, is to get to that trial in the coming, basically in the next 12 months. We really want to get there in order to get to market to help start to scale for people that need it.
So how do you see that playing out? I mean, you as a person who understands deeply the technology, and as I say, holds patents, it's almost like you're a deep consultant in the early phases,
yeah.
you know, phase zero, if you will, phase one. As you get through those trials and you start to scale, what type of go-to-market folks are you looking for? Is it a similar profile? Is it,
yeah.
or is it sort of more generalists?
Yeah, it's a great question, because I think there's multiple stakeholders along this journey, and that we have to kind of make sure we build an infrastructure to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So if you think about the interventionalist, so we need to have sales folks and or clinically minded folks that can go and say, let me help you with the surgery. Even though it's a standard techniques, we need somebody there, a Synchron representative, to be, you know, in the hospital, making sure that, you know, this is inserted in the right way.
Mm-hmm.
Then you look at and say, well, where are the users? Where are the patients in the community? Do they go to, you know, clinics? Do they go to rehab? And where are they? Who's that managing physician that we need to call on to introduce the technology? So we're going to have a field team out there in the community to introduce this technology to those managing physicians, whether it's physiatrist, neurologist, those that are dealing with these diseases and or rehabilitating from a trauma. So it's making sure that we're out there in the community. Lastly is, we need people to go help train on how to use the device. So field clinical engineers that are in the user's homes, that are there and they say, hey, let's get you up and running, let's get you activated, let's you get you using the system. And believe it or not, most people think, well, how many months is that? It's not months, it's like hours. So that's the name of the game, is have it really out of the box training, you know, so they can say it's very intuitive training. So it's like, I can start using my iPhone day one. And that's really important. So we'll also have a field team that goes to the home to be able to manage any of the technical and activate with the patients. And eventually that may go to, you know, occupational therapist or a speech language pathologist. That may be, you know, a training that gets done to therapists that are already there in the homes. But ultimately we want to make sure that we're delivering the right therapy and that it's a win for the entire community and not just the patient itself.
So Synchron's been around for, what, 13 years
yeah.
roughly?
Yep.
And so you've got some patient capital,
yeah.
obviously. Do you generate revenue at this point or no?
Yeah, so
not yet, right?
No revenue. So, right. Yeah, we're not selling the data. We're not selling the devices, the data, or anything like that. It's important that before revenue that we get the product right.
Yep.
And every patient that we've worked with to date, all 10 of them have just been fundamental understanding how this innovative technology works. You know, how do we develop the algorithms and the models to have that generic out-of-the-box feel in that connection? That's all done with working with individuals that use the system and saying, you know, what's that training look like? How does that work? And how do the algorithms now apply to that to give you that type of control over the digital environment? So, no revenue yet. I'm excited when that day comes. But I'm not in a rush. I want to do it right.
Yeah, you're not scaling your go-to-market yet because you're still
figuring out getting
the product right.
Yeah.
Are we talking years before we start to see these patient outcomes? I mean, this decade or?
Yeah, so, well, the good thing, I think, we have data today to show that from a safety standpoint, that we're on the right direction, that going this minimally invasive route is stable, and that there's a great safety profile around our approach. When you think about when we'll see this to market, when people say, hey, I'm going to go talk to my doctor about this and see if I'm a candidate. That will happen in our trial coming up here in the pivotal, so that's one thing. And people can go to synchronbci.com to learn more about that, so that's important. And then when you think about the commercial environment, most people think, oh, is this 20 years out where we see these brain-computer interfaces on the market? No, it's much shorter than that. So I think within, you know, under 5 years, and probably under really 3 years, we'll start to see these on market where people can say, let me talk to my doctor about this and see if it's right for me.
Do you think AI in any way accelerates that? I mean, AI being the AI heard around the world, you know, generative AI.
Well, it's certainly not only a buzzword, I think it's impacting every one of us right now.
For sure.
And there's no question that AI plays a massive role in brain-computer interface. And I think in several areas that to understand neural patterns or create novel features and control over that digital environment, I think that's where AI can come in, looking at large data sets. I think you think about just how we're utilizing AI today through efficiency. So if you think about the output that you're providing through your neural signal and say, how do you can you amplify that output with AI? And so thinking about different features and efficiencies through controlling your digital device and understanding that the digital device, understanding what you want to do, that agentic AI to be able to get more out of your computer, your smart device, and can you more easily talk to that AI using your neural signal is something that we're looking at, right? We've partnered with NVIDIA to bring in more environmental context, both visual and audio and neural signals together to create better visual data sets for AI. So yes, AI is a big play for what we're doing.
Amazing, and the business model, obviously you'll get paid for selling for the device.
Yeah.
Is there a data play as well, anonymized of course?
Yeah, I think so in the long run, I think we're exploring and developing that opportunity, is getting good feedback for those that have that data element to it. But I think there is a play, because if you think about some of our patients have had ALS. And so think about for the first time ever, that we have a novel data set digitizing the disease of ALS and that progress. It's a progressive disease.
Right.
So is there value eventually in this disease progression of understanding how the cells connect and talk to each other for a disease like ALS, and is the biotech companies interested in that? My guess is probably, right? And so I think there's interesting ways that, of course, we're developing a device to a neuroprosthetic to help people connect to a device, but is there value also in the data set adjunctively to other things to understand disease and help cure diseases? I think the answer is probably yes, but we're not focused on that right now, but I think it's an exciting future for us.
Yeah, I mean, when you scale,
yeah,
you know, that's
absolutely.
You're going to have some really massive amounts of data that are going to be quite useful.
I think so,
to
yes.
A lot of organizations. Yep. Kurt, thanks so much for coming in, and good luck.
Appreciate
really
it,
really important
awesome.
Work that you guys are doing.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
All right. Okay, keep it right there. You're watching MedTech Unplugged from theCUBE and NYSE Wired. Here at our studio at the Buttonwood Podium overlooking the Options Exchange, I'm Dave Vellante. For John Furrier, keep it right there. We'll be right back right after this short break.